this moment. I have trained hard for this moment. I tell myself, stay focused. Stay calm. See the space. And believe in your blockers. I know I trust my training. Do you? Get some athletics.
You're watching WFDDA.TV.
We're here in the helmet laboratories today testing some helmets. We are testing soft foam helmets versus hard foam helmets. We have the Lifer hard foam CPSC certified on the head form now. We're gonna drop it from the drop tower and we're gonna measure the G-force of the impact. We're gonna take this helmet up 2 meters for its drop. In order to pass this test, this helmet must reduce the energy pulse to under 300 Gs. Hit 186.75 Gs, that's a pass. We've got a soft foam helmet on the head form now. We're gonna bring it up to the same distance we did the hard foam helmet and see what happens. As you can see, the soft foam helmet that was dropped from the same distance as the hard foam helmet registered an 827 peak G. The hard foam helmet registered a 186. 300 Gs passes the CPSC certified test. This helmet fails.
Good morning, or it's afternoon now, technically, is it not?
We are 2 minutes away from noon, so we're still morning.
Just in there.
Got in just in time.
I'm Double Agent. This is Kim. Deal with it. We are going to bring you an awesome bout for seventh place. Terminal City taking on New Hampshire.
And these two teams came in as the ninth and tenth seeds. They're guaranteed to finish above their seeding. And also, Double H, these two teams have been essentially a mirror image of each other. Had an upset in the first round. New Hampshire had the upset over Jackson. By 19 points, and then Terminal City with the upset over Tampa Bay. And then they both had, in the quarterfinal rounds, extremely close first halves before the higher seeds ended up locking it down.
Both of these teams should be really proud of the work they did with the one and two seed, respectively. Of course, New Hampshire took on Angel City, and Terminal City took on Texas Roller Girls, who is headed to the championship bout. So really great work from both of these teams. Let's hit these rosters really quickly, Kim.
Let's introduce you to the Terminal City All-Stars. They are from Vancouver, British Columbia. Number 11, 11, Ingram. Number 12, 23, Kim Janna. 13, Richardson. 18, McKenzie. 1-Up Co. 31, Eve Hollows. 44, Lulu Demon. 45, Barbaric. 47, Scarlet Bloodbath. 52, Eveda Perone. 69, Flower Plower. 77, Sugget, in I think our favorite name of the tournament. 84, Buffy St. Fury, and MG42 Griffith.
And for Skate Free or Die All-Stars, number 12, Live in Fear, 1990, Seton Spots, number 207, Cruliet Lewis, number 21, Pammy Decker, number 26, Chicka Chicka Bam Bam, number 33, Chicana Bruzia, 341, Enrage and Grace, number 36, Bash, number 550, Tanked Girl, number 6, Makilla Queen, number 6, Swerko, number 85, Punky, 9, Emma Donnelly, and PM5, Game Ovaries. And that is my favorite name of the tournament.
There's a lot of good names. Looks like we're going to be lining up with Swerko jamming for New Hampshire. She's number 60, going against Eveda Perone, number 52 for Terminal City.
Eveda Perone looking for an outside line. Can't quite find one. Squeezes through on her toe stops, looking to face that two wall up front. Great work by those two New Hampshire defenders, opening a hole on the inside for their jammer to get through. Lead jammer status goes to New Hampshire right away.
And New Hampshire did a great job almost subtly opening up that inside lane for Swerko. However, it also enabled Eveda Perone to escape the pack as well.
Walling up at the back, New Hampshire does a good work for their jammer. 1 point there for Swerko. That was just a nice little hole for her to grab 1 point before she called it immediately, seeing that Terminal City was right behind her.
And on paper, this is one of those games that looks like it's going to be very back and forth, especially with the ways they've been playing throughout this entire tournament. Literally, it's almost been a mirror image of each other.
Game Ovaries on the jammer line for Skate Free or Die. That is Kim Janna for Terminal City. She was really happy to be here. I interviewed her earlier in the weekend, and Terminal City is just ecstatic to have a stake in this tournament right now, duking it out for seventh place out there. Jana looking for an inside line, coming up against a three wall of New Hampshire defenders. Great work, nice brace there from New Hampshire. She is able to get through lead jammer for Terminal City in the red and white.
And that was really good resilience by Kim Jana, not only to fight against a three wall, but to also force the out of play situation.
Great work. Recycling game ovaries in the back from New Hampshire. She is looking for an inside line, gets forced to the ground and must be recycled again. Meanwhile, we do have Mackenzie going to the penalty box for Terminal City as their jammer Jana really works on the front line. Good work there from New Hampshire, but they have to let her go. That is a 5-point pass for Terminal City.
And the penalty on the pivot for Terminal City, Mackenzie, was a clockwise block.
And that is a three wall allowing Jana to snake around them. That is Buffy St. Fury going to the penalty box as well. Now we are 4-on-2 pack advantage for New Hampshire. Finally, their jammer ovaries through. She is on her initial pass.
Clockwise block was also assisted to Buffy St. Fury as she went on her way into the notorious RED penalty box. But a forearm penalty is going to send Kim Jana into the penalty box just as she was about to call it off.
A little bit of confusion there. Game ovaries thought that jam was called. She was slowing down in the pack, but she sneaks through with 5 points. This is an opportunity for New Hampshire to really put some points on the board. They have pack advantage, 4-on-2. Just a two wall up at the front. That's Griffith really slowing her down there, and Eva Hallows from Terminal City getting an out of play call, I believe, going to the penalty box. That's 5 more points for New Hampshire.
And it looks like Eve Hallows is going to be able to sit because Mackenzie is now sitting in the penalty box. Clockwise blocks have accounted for 3 out of the 4 penalty minutes for Terminal City thus far.
And that's the out of play warning from the inside pack referee allowing New Hampshire's jammer to get through. Game ovaries gets 5 more points, and we are going to reset as a power jam, Kim.
4 points are going to be tacked onto the tally for Terminal City. It's going to be 16-9 in favor of New Hampshire as we have about 26 and a half minutes left to go here in the first period. Our next jam is going to be brought to you by Rydell Skates, the official skate of the WFTDA, with unmatched quality and unmatched performance. Find them on the web at rydellskates.com.
All right, well, a huge opportunity here for Chicana Bruiser to really put some points down there. She's jamming unopposed right now, power jam for New Hampshire, skate free or die.
It's 4-on-1 in the pack just as Buffy St. Fury emerges from the notorious RED penalty box.
So we do have 3-on-2 now, pack advantage still to New Hampshire. We do have one defender headed to the penalty box, the notorious RED penalty box, and through for a 5-point pass. That is Chicana Bruzia for New Hampshire, number 33-33.
Emma Donnelly is the skater in the penalty box for Skate Free or Die with an out-of-play penalty in third jam. And we've already seen this many times from Terminal City. The star pass is in play.
Great work on the inside there, finding a hole without much of a problem. We are now 3-on-3, back with a second jammer out of the box. Finally, and that star pass, so we do have 3-on-3, and Chicana Bruzia has her work cut out for her here, getting forced to the inside between turns 1 and 2. She is looking to be recycled. She's still lead jammer. She realizes that, calling it off, seeing Terminal City's jammer approach the back of the pack.
And Terminal City right now already sitting on 5 penalty minutes to New Hampshire's 1. Penalties were a bit of a problem for Terminal City in their game against Texas Double H. 5 penalty minutes in the first 5 minutes of the game is something they are going to need to focus on very quickly.
And we are resetting with Barbaric on the jammer line against Punky.
Punky really first started to jam in this tournament against Kansas City yesterday. So it looks like they're going to go with the hot hand here, Double H.
Punky really coming up behind that nicely braced wall in the back, allowing Terminal City's jammer to become through for lead jammer. And another defender from New Hampshire headed to the penalty box.
New Hampshire skater on her way to the box is CN Spots, number 1990. And if you're just joining us, New Hampshire's in the white. Terminal City is in the red.
Punky finally through on her initial pass. Barbaric really gets through that front wall, sending the first defender from New Hampshire to the floor. She looks behind her, has 4 points in the sky, and she calls it.
So some awareness there by Barbaric to kind of see if maybe her defense can get further into the front so they cannot be scored upon. Remember, of course, points accumulate until the fourth whistle, so great awareness there by Barbaric to wait to call off the jam. That's going to bring it to 28-13 in favor of New Hampshire with 24 minutes left to go here in the first period.
Well, one of the names on everybody's lips yesterday is on the jammer line, Swerko. She did a tremendous job jamming for Skate Free or Die this entire weekend. She is back on that line right now, coming up against Lulu Demon for Terminal City. Looking for a way through that sea of red in front of her. She's getting forced to the inside on her toe stops. Hasn't been forced out of bounds, though. Great work, great footwork. Still looking for a lateral way in through that back three wall. Meanwhile, Lulu Demon coming up against a two wall from New Hampshire. Each one of these, beautiful hole on the inside. Skate Free or Die does exactly that. Swerko through to become lead jammer for New Hampshire, but Lulu Demon's right behind her.
And even though the numbers were not in favor of New Hampshire, they did a great job of finding that inside lane, but again, they left the lane open for Lulu Demon, and Lulu Demon was able to escape as well.
And calling it, Swerko on the outside grabs 3 points. Great work on the outside for Skate Free or Die, looking right away to see where her hips were. Great jammer awareness.
And New Hampshire was trying to speed up the pack. Swerko managed to get around, but because New Hampshire had two skaters in the box, all she had to do was pass that one skater for the ghost points in that 28-16 in favor of New Hampshire. This is a great game thus far, Double H.
New Hampshire really needing to put the momentum here right away. We've seen a lot of teams put a lot of momentum forth in the first period, the first few jams, and I think that's what's happening. Aveda Peron on the outside, right through to become lead jammer. Game over, he's still stuck behind a four wall of red, looking for some help from her blocker. She gets a little bit of help, but still, this is an opportunity for Aveda to come through, and she does. That is a 5-point pass for Terminal City.
Correction, it looks like a 5-point pass as Flower Plower is on the way into the notorious RED penalty box for a multiplayer block.
And we are still looking at a way on the outside. Beautiful lateral work from Aveda Peron to make it through 4 points, and she calls it, really shutting New Hampshire down on that jam.
Terminal City now inching closer. New Hampshire with the lead, 28-25, as we have 22 minutes left to go here in the first period. Our next jam is going to be brought to you by Printco. For all of your printing needs, hit up printcographics.com.
That is Chicana Abruzzi on the jammer line with Barbaric. Each one of these skaters capable of greatness. New Hampshire 28, Terminal City 25, and just under 22 minutes right now. Whistles off. We do have beautiful work from Chicana Abruzzi getting through on the inside, not quite through. One defender to beat, and then another great work up at the front from Terminal City, keeping her behind them, getting some help from her blockers, but getting pushed to the inside, and now Barbaric through to become lead jammer for Terminal City.
And that was great work by Eve Hollows to try and slow down Chicana Abruzzi while Buffy St. Fury leapt into the front of the pack to sort of assist and get their jammer through.
And that is called by Terminal City. Really, the problem there was that her blockers were forced to the inside, and she didn't have a whole lot of help. New Hampshire did not have a whole lot of help for their jammer there, but great work on both these teams' side. We are still looking at New Hampshire's lead, though, by just 2 points.
And Terminal City's done a great job of keeping New Hampshire scoreless for the last three jams, although I have the feeling New Hampshire, sending Punky up to the line, really wants to get back into this and break that streak.
And that is Lulu Demon on the line for Terminal City. Punky looking for a line on the inside, coming up behind a nice three wall of Terminal City defenders. They force her to the inside. She gets in on her toe stops and back in cleanly. Looking for a line on the outside. She gets forced to the ground. And that is an out-of-play call against Terminal City, allowing her to become lead jammer for Skate Free or Die.
Richardson heading into the notorious RED penalty box, as it looks like Punky has already worked her way completely around and is on a scoring pass, Double H.
Punky has one to beat for that final point, and that was Suggett. She gets past, and that is a 5-point pass for New Hampshire.
So New Hampshire widening their lead now as Lulu Demon still trapped in the pack.
That's Live in Fear keeping her behind, and great work there in the back from New Hampshire's defenders. We do have Punky really coming in behind, gets forced to the ground on her knees and back up now. She's eyeing up the back of the pack for more points.
Lulu Demon has escaped the pack now as she has completed the initial pass on her way for a scoring pass.
And that was a takeout from her own defender for Punky. Now up against her own three wall up at the front from Terminal City. That is a 4-point pass, I believe, or three. We'll take a look really quickly to see what that was.
If I'm not mistaken, it was a three-point pass, so 36-26, New Hampshire widening up their lead. I mentioned that Terminal City in the first 5 minutes had five penalties. In the last 6 minutes, they've only accumulated three, so Terminal City already looking like they're cleaning things up. New Hampshire doing incredible work in terms of the penalty board, only three penalty minutes for the entire team.
And that is Swirko on the jammer line for New Hampshire, coming up against Kim Janna for Terminal City. Swirko looking on the outside, really working that outside line, not finding much luck. Kim Janna coming up behind a three wall of defenders, and she beats him. Terminal City is through for lead jammer status.
And Kim Janna did a really good job of sort of running on her toe stops and trying to split that two wall in the front.
And there's a no-pack call allowing Swirko to get through for her initial pass. Janna's still working on the inside. Jukes laterally, makes it through for 4 points and calls it.
So again, that, as our, like I've mentioned Reverend Almighty before, in the punch counter punch, 36-30, as we have 18 minutes left to go here in the first period. New Hampshire has the lead, and our next jam is going to be brought to you by Bruce Skate Noose, the original over-the-shoulder roller skate holder.
One of the fun challenges here this weekend is that the color of the walls in this venue is almost the exact same color as the jammer ref's fingers. So sometimes trying to determine how many points were obtained can be a challenge. That is Aveda Peron, though, jamming against. That is game overies for New Hampshire, coming up against that nice brace of a two-wall up at the front from Terminal City, forcing her almost out of bounds. She is coming back behind that two-wall, though. Great work from Eve Hollows at the front, allowing just enough time for Terminal City's jammer to get through. Aveda Peron, lead jammer.
And Terminal City has had a really good 1-2 punch of Aveda Peron and Kim Janna, just as New Hampshire's had a great 1-2 punch of Chicana Brugia and game overies, as well as Swirko added in there as well.
And feeling New Hampshire's jammer behind her, just feeling her death stare. Terminal City calls it for a gain of two. I have a feeling it's going to go like this for the rest of the bout. They're going to have to take the points that they can get, because neither one of these teams is going to give them up very easily.
Absolutely. And if you'd like to let us know what you're thinking out there on Twitter, make sure you use the hashtag talk, the number two, WFTDA, as McKenzie, I'm sorry, it is Barbaric lined up for Terminal City, going up against Chicana Brugia for New Hampshire.
Barbaric looking for an outside line, comes up against a sea of white. Chicana Brugia also now jumping to the inside, outside, swerves back inside, and now there is a no-pack call allowing her to get through to become lead jammer.
And it looks like Flower Plower false started as the jam began, had to take the backwards lap before she could re-enter play.
Barbaric through for her initial pass. We are 3-on-2 pack advantage for Terminal City. Chicana, though, sizing those defenders up. She gets her hips in front of none of them, Kim. It did look from this perspective that she might have gotten it, but she did not.
It was so close, but Ref Sputin and Professor Murder, the jam refs out there, two of the best ones around, in my humble opinion, as we're still really, really close right now, 36-32. Relatively low-scoring game in comparison to the other scorelines we've had in the tournament, Double H.
But really, you can see why each one of these teams defensively doing such a good job. And that is Swirko on the jammer line for New Hampshire against Lulu Demon, who finds an outside line coming up against a two-wall of New Hampshire defenders on the inside. She sneaks through for lead jammer status.
And Lulu Demon is very evasive in the pack. That's one of the things I've enjoyed watching from Terminal City, is her ability to find just the smallest of holes and even mohawk her way through.
And that's a no-pack call allowing Swirko to take a couple jumps forward. The pack reforms, though, and she's still behind that two-wall. That is McKenzie in the front doing that lovely bracing with Eve Hallows, forcing her out of bounds, but she gets back in cleanly, and she might not have been out of bounds. We could just barely see the boundary here from right where we are.
And Terminal City pulls within 1 point, picking up 3 points in the last jam. However, they lost Griffith to the notorious RED penalty box for a track cut. And of course, the notorious RED is providing all of the great sponsorship to the penalty box. They help you smell clean, even if you play dirty. Find them on the web at notoriousred.com.
After 3 days of roller derby, just announcing, I think I really need the opportunity to smell better myself.
Oh, I think we all do.
Game overies. Kim Janna duking it out here. Game overies on the outside for lead jammer, New Hampshire.
And she found that outside line and just went through completely unnoticed. Great awareness there by Game Overies.
Kim Janna through for her initial pass. We're still 3-on-3 in this pack. We do have Game Overies sizing up that three while at the front. Down goes Scarlett, and she gets the back block call, I think.
It does appear the game over. She's definitely in the notorious RED penalty box, which will make this power jam Terminal City. We will go the full 2 minutes. It was a forearm call on game over.
So still great work for Terminal City drawing that call off of Scarlett. We do have Jana coming back. We are now 4-on-2 pack advantage for New Hampshire. Let's see what their four wall of defenders can do. Nice brace at the front, keeping Kim Jana behind them. Still, that central two wall, now a three wall, bracing nicely. Really slowing her down, Kim. They're doing such a good job with that.
Yeah, there's been some great lateral movement by New Hampshire, but Kim Jana sort of mohawked her way around the outside line. That's going to be another scoring pass completed. 5 points in that one, as well as 5 points from the first pass.
And round she comes again. This time, Terminal City not having any of it. They completely smash New Hampshire's three wall slash four wall, and now she's getting a forearm penalty for trying to get past Live in Fear. We are now on a New Hampshire power jam.
And game over, he was standing in the notorious RED penalty box, so this will be at least 50 seconds in the box for Kim Jana.
We are 4-on-3 pack advantage for New Hampshire. Defenders doing a great job not getting any out of play calls for New Hampshire. So this is a full deck of cards for New Hampshire to work with here. Slowly winding her way through game ovaries, trying to make it past Scarlett Bloodbath, who drew that call, and right away she's back in cleanly for 5 points, New Hampshire.
And that was very smart because the Terminal City blockers were already on their way moving backwards, and game ovaries snuck right behind Scarlett Bloodbath to get back into play.
All right, now we're going to reset. That was a 4-point pass before going to the penalty box for Terminal City. So we're still looking at Terminal City 49, New Hampshire 41, with just under 13 minutes.
And it's important to note the power jam does carry over. And something else that I think is also important to note, this will be Kim Jana's third penalty minute for Terminal City. So already one of their star players is in danger of fouling out of the game with three penalty minutes in the first 18 minutes of the game.
And Chicana Bruzia is jamming for New Hampshire. She does not have any penalties, and that is exactly what New Hampshire needs. She is coming up behind Suggett and Richardson. Now they must allow her to go. She's lead jammer for New Hampshire.
Yeah, Chicana Bruzia has been one of the cleanest skaters I've seen in the tournament. I don't believe I've seen her penalty minutes go over three for each game of the tournament.
She is now coming up behind a two-all again. And Mackenzie Richardson, great work up there from Terminal City, but she beats him. That is a 5-point pass for New Hampshire. This is where Skate Free or Die can return the favor and put some points on the board.
Power jam is over as Kim Jana has returned to action from the notorious RED penalty box.
And coming up again, Suggett throws her to the ground between turns one and two. Chicana Bruzia really forced to pull all the way back, recycled by Terminal City nicely. She's sizing up the back of the pack. Suggett moves all the way back to meet her and cause her some problems. Coming up against a three wall, beautiful brace up there from Terminal City.
And in the meantime, New Hampshire is doing some great lateral movement to keep Kim Jana restrained in the back.
Chicana through for 5 more points. We now have a lead change. New Hampshire 51, Terminal City 49.
Mackenzie is on her way into the penalty box for a high block penalty. This will be her second penalty minute.
And that is a great opening for her on the inside for Chicana. She is looking to get past this two wall. Great work from Suggett and Flower at the front from Terminal City, but they get the out of play warning and they're forced to let her go.
And that is going to be a completion of another scoring pass. Kim Jana still on her initial, so 5 points there for New Hampshire.
And Chicana actually looks at Kim Jana and kind of gives her a little smile before getting through the pack an additional time, and that's another lap point for her. This is a 5-point pass for New Hampshire.
Kim Jana has escaped the pack. You do not see it on the screen, but she has completed her initial pass here as we have 8 seconds left in the jam.
And we are 3-on-3 in that pack. Chicana trying to figure out if she can do any work before, and she cannot. We are empty for that final pass, Kim.
So right now, 20-point jam here for New Hampshire as penalties really, really starting to accumulate on both sides. We mentioned Kim Jana at 3 penalty minutes. Richardson, Mackenzie, and Griffith all have 2 penalty minutes for Terminal City. Skate Free or Die, New Hampshire has 2 skaters with 2 penalty minutes. That is Live in Fear and Emma Donnelly.
New Hampshire 61, Terminal City 49. We just have 10 minutes to go in the first period. That is Punky and Aveda Perron jamming. Punky looking for an inside line, cannot find it. Aveda Perron coming up behind. One defender beats her and is through to become lead jammer.
And Chicka Chicka Bam Bam was outside of the pack definition. That enabled Aveda Perron to get lead jammer status.
We do still have Punky working on Buffy at the front. She gets past her, afraid of that out of play call. And Aveda is through, calls it immediately for 4 points.
So when we return to action here, well, the score is 61-53. What a game we're seeing here thus far. And when we return to action, our next jam is going to be brought to you by Viva Las Vegas Photo Booth. You can check out the photos from the WFTDA Photo Booth, sponsored by Viva Las Vegas Skates, at facebook.com/WFTDA. There's been some great photos that have already been posted on our
great
Facebook page.
And embarrassing photos, Kim. And
that's roller derby in a nutshell, isn't it?
That's kind of what's great. That's what's great about it. Swerko jamming for New Hampshire. Barbaric, though, looking for a line on the outside. Great work from New Hampshire's defenders, pushing her out on the outside. And she just barely avoids that track cut as she's recycled in the back by Live in Fear. Great work from New Hampshire there. Nice four-wall, though, bracing from Terminal City, allowing their jammer to get through for lead jammer status.
So Barbaric was able to recover from that near track cut, went ahead and gained that lead jammer status. Some great work there by Barbaric.
Swerko still working on this three wall up at the front. Terminal City, meanwhile, allowing their jammer to get through on the inside. Barbaric for 5 points.
So Terminal City right now with only 3 points separating them from New Hampshire. We've already had a couple of lead changes in this game, Double H.
Really great bracing work from Terminal City up at the front, keeping Swerko at bay. But that is a forearm call, sending Barbaric to the penalty box. Power jam, New Hampshire.
And that is going to be Barbaric's first penalty minute. So she's been relatively clean up until this point.
Swerko is very carefully navigating this wall of Terminal City defenders. They are recycling her very well. Mackenzie Flower doing a nice job. They get the no pack call, though. She's allowed to get through. That was her initial pass, Kim.
And during the course of that initial pass, Suggett was assessed a clockwise block, so that will be her second penalty minute.
So we're seeing a three-on-three pack advantage neither, but power jam for New Hampshire coming up against Mackenzie and Flower. Plowher Swerko's very slowly working her way through. She does not want to get a penalty, which she does incur. She is headed to the penalty box for a back block, Kim.
So it's going to be interesting to see just how many points were picked up by both jammers, because both jammers were on scoring passes when they went into the penalty box. Looks like, I believe that is Eve Hallows. I'm sorry, no, that is Ingram heading into the penalty box for Terminal City.
And that is Barbaric out of the penalty box on her scoring run. She has 4 points there, but we do have three from New Hampshire.
So New Hampshire will retain a razor-thin lead here, 64-62, as we have less than 7 minutes left to go in the game. When we return to action, our next jam will be brought to you by Cruise Skate Shop, offering quality-tested derby gear and guidance since 2007. Find them on the web at cruiseskateshop.com, and make sure you spell Cruise, C-R-U-Z.
So a silver lining here for New Hampshire on the power jam. They do have four blockers on the track. Aveda Perron is going to try to get through them right now. She does a good job laterally jumping. Ooh, nice hit there at the front from Bash, though. She is through to become lead jammer for Terminal City.
And it does appear that Bash picked up a penalty. That's Pam Decker that's on her way to the Notorious R.E.D. penalty box.
Aveda Perron getting sent to the floor on the inside on that hit, really still working through her way through, I should say. But that is a 5-point pass for Terminal City.
And Terminal City will take back the lead, 67-64. Action continuing here, Double H.
3-on-3, Aveda Perron really cuts through that back wall nicely and beats very quickly on the outside two defenders from New Hampshire. 5-point pass, but we do have New Hampshire's jammer, that Swerko, back from the penalty box.
And just a quick note from the penalty box, it does appear that there was an illegal procedure that was assessed to Pam Decker as well, so she's going to serve 2 minutes in the box, Double H.
We are through and around Swerko through her initial pass and still retaining lead jammer status. That was Aveda Perron. She looked up and sized up where her opposing jammer was and called it right away.
Great power jam there by Terminal City. You see how happy they are on the screen, 74-64. But this lead, just like the rest of them in this game, absolutely not safe. 5 minutes left to go here in the period.
So that was a power jam, but New Hampshire really not making it easy on Terminal City. We're still just a 10-point difference here. Lulu Demon on the line for Terminal City, and that is game overies on the line for New Hampshire.
Back advantage will be in favor of Terminal City, 4-on-3 in the pack, as Pam Decker still serving that 2-minute penalty.
Lulu Demon looking at an outside line coming up behind a nice three, no pack call, a nice three wall, but the no pack call allows her to get through. Lulu Demon is lead jammer for Terminal City.
And right now the pack sort of spread out. Terminal City trying to get that front wall to control game overies there.
Terminal City doing a good job knocking. Game over, he's out, but she comes back in. Oh, Scarlett was angry because she felt like she drew the cut and the officials did not agree. Oh no, the officials did agree.
They did certainly agree. As game over, he's now in the penalty box for a track cut. Power jam in favor of Terminal City.
Look at that nice gift there. We do have 4-on-1 pack advantage on this power jam as well. That's Donnelly out there solo right now for New Hampshire, but it does look as though we have another New Hampshire defender returning from the box. I'm not sure if she's in the queue.
I believe she is, in fact, queued because the New Hampshire side of the box is full.
And that is Live in Fear. So we've got a full line of defenders from Terminal City and just two blockers. Now, Donnelly not quite sure if she's allowed to get in there, asking for some help from her bench.
Well, if she was actually also signaled out for a penalty, was Emil Donnelly, an out-of-play penalty. So right now, both blockers on the track for New Hampshire are queued for the box.
And this is a really big problem for them on a power jam with a full complement of blockers from Terminal City. Live in Fear now defending by herself. Decker back from the penalty box. Another five-point pass there for Terminal City, making this 99 to New Hampshire's 64.
And looking to break that 100-point mark as Emma Donnelly has made her way into the Notorious RED penalty box, serving that cued penalty.
And game over is back out from the penalty box. She's making it past the front four, an initial pass, and that looks like Suggett headed to the penalty box for an out-of-play call, tangling with Overy's far past the point of where she should have. No points on that pass for game Overy's, and this is a timeout New Hampshire.
Team timeout for New Hampshire, and what I think is interesting is that Live in Fear, I don't believe, actually reported to the penalty box because a spot opened up, and Pam Decker was given a penalty just as that spot opened up, so she sat down. I don't know if Live in Fear has actually served her time or not, but Terminal City Double H in these last couple of jams really starting to pour it on New Hampshire.
I think that you're absolutely right about that, and I think, let's take a look. We do have three penalties for New Hampshire's Live in Fear, three penalties for Pam Decker, three for Emma Donnelly, and then on the Terminal City side, we've got three for Kim Janna, which could be problematic further on, as you mentioned.
Yeah, and also three penalty minutes for Suggett as well. Yep. And she has been absolutely fantastic in the pack. That shoulder to sternum contact that she made a few jams back really shows her awareness in the fact that she made that contact, recycled the jammer, and then went all the way to the back. But penalty minute wise, it's been completely even, 17 penalty minutes apiece for both teams.
I think the difference is where all of these penalties have occurred for Skate Free or Die. Within the last two jams is really where they've had their difficulties. Pam Decker had two in the 17th jam alone. And we are listening to make sure that we are back in play. New Hampshire 64, Terminal City 103. And we do have a delay of game penalty now being assessed.
And if a delay of game penalty is assessed, I believe it would be assessed because Live in Fear was not supposed to be in the box. Johnny Cash Machine, you don't see on the screen, motion that, hey, you're supposed to be out there. So Live in Fear coming back out there is the pivot. Delay of game penalties in this situation, that's actually going to be a delay of game, and it is going to go to Live in Fear. So now she's not only queued for the box, she's queued for 2 minutes, Double H.
That's Kim Janna through to become lead jammer for Terminal City. Chicana Bruzy hot on her heels, though. We do have both jammers breaking the pack. Kim Janna, lead jammer for Terminal City.
So as a moment of procedure there, Live in Fear did have to report to the penalty box and be waved off, and I think that helped Terminal City in that last go-around.
I did think Chicana Bruzy had maybe gotten a point or two, but nope. Beautiful work from Terminal City's Kim Janna calling it off just in time, and both of these teams remain scoreless on that jam. Terminal City 103, New Hampshire 64 with just over, under now, 2.5 minutes.
And when this next jam begins, it'll be brought to you by Adam Wheels, a proud partner and the official wheel of the WFTDA. Find them on the web at adamwheels.com. And hey, an official timeout being called here. Does not appear to be declared an official review. It is an official timeout. I believe, if I had to guess, it's going to be about clarifying penalties, especially with Live in Fear. And I'm not sure specifically what they're going to be discussing. But Double H, what a great game we've seen so far. The last two jams have made the scoreline a little bit wider than you would think it would be.
And as we mentioned, the penalties, yeah, and I think the reason for that is because we have two penalties alone from Live in Fear in the 18th jam. And two penalties alone from Pam Decker in the 17th jam. Another penalty from Emma Donnelly in the 18th and Gabe Overy's in the 18th. So these last two jams have been really difficult for New Hampshire. as Terminal City's penalties are a little bit more spread out between the jams, Kim.
And some conversation out there on Twitter, Punchin' Meat, which that's a great name, by the way, says, thing to love about Terminal City is the bench, seeing Buffy St. Fury being supportive and encouraging her teammate, Evada Perón.
And that is Punky jamming for Skate Free or Die against Evada Perón for Terminal City, who's through to become lead jammer. And we do have a nice three wall up at the front. It is 3-on-1 pack advantage for Terminal City, but that does not stop Punky from really doing a nice job there. Gets past Scarlet Bloodbath. That is a 5-point pass for Evada Perón, and Punky's through for her initial pass.
And I heard Bam Bam mutter something about that's interesting. Bam Bam, what was the cause of the official timeout?
Number 12-12, Live in Fear for New Hampshire, was actually injured. She had been sent to the penalty box, but as we saw, she was not in the box at that moment. So that official timeout was just to make sure what the reasoning was and to find a substitute for her in the penalty box while she was being tended to.
So it looks like Bash is serving the time in the penalty box. She's currently seated, although she only has one penalty minute assessed, so it looks like she is the designated substitute for Live in Fear, who is injured, but do we have any word on the injury? Looks like she is sitting with the medics right now. If we get more information, we will let you know at home.
And we are off. Swerko is jamming against Barbaric. 2-on-2 in the pack. Now 2-on-3 pack advantage for New Hampshire. Decker's back from the box. And now Suggett's back from the box. Up at the front, though, Barbaric. Oh, beautiful work on the outside from Swerko. Gets forced out by McKenzie, though, allowing her jammer to become through. Terminal City lead jammer.
And right now, pack advantage it's not really advantage, it's 3-on-3, but Terminal City with some great lateral movement to try and pocket Swerko in the front wall.
And Swerko working on a two wall up at the front now. That's McKenzie, who's done such a good job blocking her out, and does again between turns 1 and 2, leaving some opportunity for Barbaric to come up the front to get through a 5-point pass. She does get that jammer lap point.
So once again, New Hampshire, their blocker getting sort of tied up in the pack there. Gets a bit of a stumble in turn number 3.
And getting forced to the ground is Barbaric. Good work in the back from New Hampshire. Swerko still working on McKenzie up at the front, who's been a beast in this game, extending in that accordion style all the way until she gets the warning. Oh, Swerko is getting a back block call from Dr. Werman. She's going to the penalty box.
So again, this is going to be a power jam in favor of Terminal City as a pass just completed. 5 points picked up here by Terminal City once again. And these last three jams, Double H, almost a 60-point run.
All right, so Barbaric eyeing up that three wall. And springing to life is Flower and McKenzie, really tearing that wall apart for their jammer. Great work. Bam Bam likes to call this the passive-aggressive offense, and I think he's right.
Yeah, because we've started to see a lot of teams employ this where they sort of fade back, let the wall stretch out, and then rush. Just what you saw it on your screen right there. Suggett tried to rush up and break up that wall.
But still great job from New Hampshire reforming. Nice brace there. We are getting the out-of-play call, though. That looks like Decker, who's getting that penalty. 5-point pass for Terminal City.
That's going to take us to halftime too as well. Double H, 132-64. And the first 25 minutes of this game, New Hampshire did incredible. And then Terminal City, they're still doing great work. It's just Terminal City has completely dominated the last 5 minutes, and it shows on the score line.
And it shows on the penalty lineup as well. The last few jams have been absolutely deadly for Skate Free or Die. It's the last 4 or 5 jams where they've really been incurring those penalties, and the types of penalties that they've been incurring really speak to the power jam, those out-of-play calls where the blockers are really trying to chase those jammers down, a few clockwise calls. So that speaks to me of a defense that's kind of working out there with maybe not a full set of blockers.
Yeah, absolutely. And if you look at the Ringster stats that we have, the first 10 jams, there's only 3 penalty minutes. All of the rest of the Skate Free or Die's penalties have come in the as soon as you go into double digits. But then at the same time, Terminal City has been fairly spread even across. However, Kim Janna has gone to the box 3 times as a jammer. I think that may result in a strategy change before when we go into the second half.
But it does look as though the last jam that she did that was maybe the 13th jam. Is that what I'm seeing?
It is correct. So
the last few jams, she's really reined that back in.
Absolutely.
I think she probably took a look at the whiteboard and said, I need to skate a little
bit
more cleanly.
Maybe I should hold off here. So New Hampshire with 20 penalties, Terminal City with 18. I don't know about you, but I think we need to take a bit of a breather.
I need to get some Durbalife liftoff in me.
You mean that all-natural energy drink for skaters and announcers alike and the official beverage of the WFTDA?
That's exactly the beverage I mean.
Well, how about we have some of that while our good friends at home watch these fine commercials from our sponsors?
Let's do it. We'll meet you back here in a few minutes.
I am 11 years old.
You're watching WFTDA.TV.
I'm Kim, deal with it here with Double H. We're back in, about to get back into action here with Terminal City versus New Hampshire. We mentioned it going into the half. New Hampshire and Terminal City very, very close in the first 25 minutes or so of the game, and then penalty trouble started racking up for Skate Free or Die. In fact, Pam Decker has had two jams where she has accumulated two penalty minutes apiece.
And one of them was the last jam. She actually had an out-of-play penalty and an insubordination. So not good news for Pammy Decker. She is one penalty away from fouling out of this game. I know that is not what Skate Free or Die wants to see.
Definitely
happen.
Definitely not, especially she is one of the veteran skaters on that team. Just had transferred from Boston, I believe, in 2012. And one of the sort of boosts they got, along with Emma Donnelly and now Shelby Shattered as one of their bench coaches. But Live in Fear also sitting on four penalty minutes. We do not know the status of her injury. Aside from that, it is a leg injury. She is back on skates and on knee pads, so I assume she will be returning to action. And Terminal City, though, on the other side, they only have two skaters who are really in any kind of penalty trouble at the moment.
Some good news, though, for Skate Free or Die. Their two most prolific jammers in this bout are not sitting on any penalties. Chicana Brusia does not have any penalties right now. Swerko does have two of them, but Punky does not. So they have some options.
Yeah, absolutely. Skate Free or Die has got some great options there. But Kim Janna and Sugget are the skaters for Terminal City, currently sitting on three penalty minutes apiece. So again, especially with most of the penalties coming in the last 10 jams or so for New Hampshire, I have a feeling the halftime talk was, let's keep it clean. We were doing great. We can get back into this. It's not an insurmountable lead.
And we do have this jam starting off with Swerko in the penalty box for a back block. She is going to be jamming when she returns against Aveda Peron, who is on the jammer line for Terminal City.
And if you're just joining us after the half, Terminal City wearing their red uniforms here today. New Hampshire is going to be in the white on your screen.
Terminal City 132, New Hampshire 64. We're 30 minutes away from finding out who takes seventh place in this tournament. Either way, both of these teams are going to move up in the seating, and they should be really proud of their performance.
Yeah, they've done some great work today. And in fact, my personal belief is that the New Hampshire-Jacksonville game was actually the game of the tournament so far. And not because I announced it, but because it was amazing.
not that you're biased in any way.
Normally that you see the 10 o'clock game on Friday not as one of the great games. That was a great game.
Aveda Peron laterally getting some help from her blockers. Makes it through on the outside to become lead jammer for Terminal City. Again, she is on a power jam.
So it looks like the passive-aggressive offense, as our good friend Bam Bam would stay in play here for Terminal City.
And you're right, Mackenzie sprung into action and opened a hole in that wall for her jammer. 5 points for Terminal City, walling up at the back to prevent Swerko from getting too far once she's out of the penalty box, which she is, but giving some room for Aveda Peron to maneuver around that two wall up at the front. She gets past on the outside. That is another 5-point pass for Terminal City.
So power jam is over. It looks like it is just Pam Decker sitting in the notorious RED penalty box for New Hampshire.
And that is a two wall now that Swerko is looking to beat up at the front. That is the out of play warning both of those defenders get from Terminal City, and Aveda Peron makes it through. Looks at her bench. says, should I call it? And they said, sure.
And I think it was interesting. She tapped her hips for one tap, which is not a call off.
Correct.
And then looked at her bench and then did the repeated tap. So a great awareness there. She went to tap the hips and then said, wait a second, I don't know if I should do this, and looked at her bench, then called it off.
Yeah, that was some lucky communication there. Kim Janna jamming for Terminal City against Game Overies for New Hampshire. We are 4-on-2 pack advantage for Terminal City.
So the Rev is out there saying, New Hampshire, say New Hampshire.
Oh,
I know.
We miss
you, Rev.
We do miss you. Kim Janna coming up against Chicka Chicka Bam Bam. Beats her, makes it through to become lead jammer for Terminal City. Game over. He's still forced down at the back of the pack. This four wall of defenders from Terminal City. Great bracing up front by McKenzie. Now a three wall. Now a four wall. Buffy St. Fury coming in to help defend. And now Kim Janna is through for 5 points.
And something that I'm noticing is that when Kim Janna is in the pack, she's not looking to skate through the outside line. She's running on her toe stops. And it's a very unique but very effective strategy there for Kim Janna.
And she looks behind her, calls it. Beautiful work. Keeping New Hampshire scoreless here. 3 points for Terminal City. They're at 154, New Hampshire 64.
And I understand there are no perfect brackets remaining in the Cheese Balls Bearings Bracket Bonanza. Make sure you go up to WFTDA.tv and fill out your brackets for next week. Of course, they are due before 10 o'clock on Friday for the Asheville tournament.
Chicana Brusia on the jammer line for Skate Free or Die. Oh, she's trying to throw some of her tape off the track.
Didn't work so well. She threw it and got stuck to her fingers because it's tape.
And that is Barbaric jamming for Terminal City. She finds a line on the outside. It is pack advantage 4-on-2 for Terminal City. So their jammer now lead. Chicana is still duking it out in the front. On her toe stops on the inside. Now a three wall turns into a two wall. She does have two to beat. That's Sugget and Flower. So she's still working on them. Both of these jammers now finally through. That is the initial pass, though, for New Hampshire. That was a five-point pass, though, for Barbaric.
And it looks like a forearm penalty was assessed to Terminal City's pivot, which is Sugget. She is in her fourth penalty minute in the notorious RED penalty box.
All right, so great work bringing the heat there from New Hampshire. Scoreless for both teams on that pass.
And in this sort of a situation, a scoreless jam is A-okay if you're on the New Hampshire side because you're preventing Terminal City from scoring. It's a great way to sort of build momentum for the next couple of jams.
And speaking of momentum, we're 4-on-3 to start this jam pack advantage for New Hampshire. Punky jamming. Again, she does not have any penalties yet in this game, and she's coming up against Lulu Demon. She finds a little hole on the inside for her blockers created for her. Now a three wall nicely braced up at the front. That's Flower and Griffith really holding her back. Still in play, though. So that's the no pack call, and she gets through. There are penalties being assessed, though, on Terminal City. That was costly for them, an out-of-play call. Punky through. She is lead jammer now working the inside line. She gets through and pass for 5 points.
So McKenzie and Griffith both in the going to the penalty box. Griffith is going to be cued for the box. She's about to return to action here.
Okay, we are 4-on-1 now, pack advantage for New Hampshire. And just as Lulu hit the back of the pack, Punky called it. That was only 1 point, though. She was able to get to Punky's 4 points. So now New Hampshire working to change the momentum.
Absolutely, and there's a lot of time in this game. I know it's a cliche. There is a lot of time left in this game, 25 minutes to make up that ground. There's 160 to 73 is the score in favor of Terminal City, but momentum definitely on New Hampshire's side.
Swirko and Aveda Peron going toe-to-toe. We are still four defenders for New Hampshire. This is an opportunity for them to do some heavy lifting for their jammer.
And Griffith is still out there. She is cued for the penalty box as well.
And through. New Hampshire Skate Free or Die gets lead jammer status. That is Swirko jamming for them. Aveda Peron is through for her initial pass. I think Swirko is going to probably try to hit it and quit it.
Well, she's already managed to get past one blocker, even though that blocker was on the outside. Jam gets called off, and it's 4 points for New Hampshire.
And really beautiful work pirouetting on the outside for Swirko to get that final fourth point. She does so very beautifully. New Hampshire 77, Terminal City 160.
So right now, penalty minutes are New Hampshire 23, Terminal City 21. But I think what a more important stat is that in the second half, only one penalty minute for New Hampshire thus far. They've been playing a very clean second half.
And that is Kim Janna on the line, who does have three of her own penalties against Game Overies. And that was a star pass from Kim Janna.
And I was wondering when we were going to see one of those. Scarlet Bloodbath, now the eligible jammer as Game Overies lead jammer for New Hampshire.
And we're going to see if Game Overies allows her to get up in the mix. And she does, of course. Game Overies looking to her blockers for some help on the inside. Makes it through to the front. There are two to beat. Yes, getting great work from her assisting blockers there. She makes it past all of the defenders at the front, including Kim Janna, who is now a blocker, and that is a four-point pass for New Hampshire.
And it's important to note, Scarlet Bloodbath, even though she was disqualified from lead jammer sets, but because she started the jam as the pivot, she is on a scoring run. New Hampshire jammer trusting her blockers to try and pick up an additional point.
And they're doing a great job for her so far, looking for an inside line. Game Overies finds it. Coming up, she has one to beat, and beautiful hit up front from Bash, allowing her some space, but now we do have Scarlet through for 4 points.
And just as Game Overies calling off the jam, that's gonna be 5 points. She did get the lap point as well there, Double H.
Yeah, she definitely wanted to control the hemorrhaging there. And we are looking at Terminal City 164, New Hampshire 86.
And when we return to action, our next jam is gonna be brought to you by Sin City Skates. First the best and happy to fix the rest. They wouldn't sell it if they wouldn't play in it. Find them on the web at sincityskates.com.
Amazing. Also amazing, Chicana Brusia on the jammer line coming up against Barbaric. Chicana Brusia, no penalties in
absolutely
this game.
And that's one of the things that's so difficult, especially as a jammer with the cut rules the way that they are.
Oh, drawing, no. Great work there from Chicana, not falling into that track cutting trap. She remains in play, and she is up against a brutal three wall there of Terminal City defenders, allowing Terminal City's jammer, Barbaric, to get through to become lead jammer.
So right now, Chicana Brugia tied up in the pack there. Buffy St. Fury being sent out for a penalty. Do not see what the penalty is just yet. It was a multiplayer block, Double H.
Seggett allowing Chicana Brusia to go after getting that out-of-play warning. That is a four-point pass for Barbaric. We are 3-on-2 in this pack. Advantage to New Hampshire. Let's see. Oh, that gets the no-pack call. And the jam comes to an end, but we do have no points there from New Hampshire.
That was very smart by Barbaric to call off the jam, especially because Chicana Brugia was about to begin a scoring pass.
And especially because that no pack call was there, and
exactly,
she knew that her blockers could not engage.
Exactly. So it was very, and Terminal City, I've been very impressed with the strategy that actually both of these teams have had the entire way around. They're definitely playing above their seeding in this tournament.
Punky and Lulu Demon on the line, and we are making use. We're dusting off the pivot line there. Four wall of New Hampshire defenders allows their jammer through. Punky now fighting a two wall. Beautiful brace there of defenders from Terminal City. And there is an inside line that they've opened, giving a tiny crack for Lulu Demon to come through to become lead jammer. A little bit of mistiming there from New Hampshire. Oh, they draw the cut on Punky, who turns around, pirouettes back onto the track after getting forced out on the outside, and now this is a power jam for Terminal City.
And I think what happened there is Ingram pushed Scarlet Bloodbath into Punky, and her right side of her right skate touched the outside track boundary, but I think she may have figured that Scarlet Bloodbath went out as well. Scarlet Bloodbath was extremely, extremely close to that line, Double H.
And we do have another track cut being assessed to a New Hampshire blocker. That's Donnelly going to the penalty box. We are 4-on-3, pack advantage for Terminal City, and we are on a power jam, so that three wall getting passive aggressively ripped apart, then nicely reforms. New Hampshire really putting the stops there to Terminal City. Great work from Live in Fear and Seeing Spots, pushing Lulu Demon back and keeping her at bay. Nice bracing up at the front, but we are gonna get a warning. Oh, there is a track cut for Terminal City, and now we will see New Hampshire come back in action to score some points on their power jam.
And it looks like Punky was standing in the notorious RED penalty box. You do not see it on your screen. She's reentering now. So about 50 seconds of a penalty here for Lulu Demon.
3-on-2 pack advantage for Terminal City, but we are going to see Punky, ooh, get forced to the inside right at turn three. Great work from Terminal City, keeping her recycled. She is making her way past the blockers. Oh, forced down And that is going to be a low block call, sending Buffy to the penalty box. That was the initial pass for Punky. Let's see what she can do when the pack is 2-on-2.
And it looks like a second penalty minute was assessed to Buffy St. Fury as well. We're going to find out what that second penalty minute was for. But Terminal City with a four-point pass, or 4 points in that last pass.
And New Hampshire is going to get to reset on a power jam. So this is an opportunity. We do have a timeout.
It's an official review, in fact, Double H.
And that is going to be, I know exactly what that is going to be, I think. That's going to be from Terminal City. I think they're going to want to investigate that track cutting call.
It was not only that, but there was a low block and then followed up by an insubordination on Buffy St. Fury. So right now, Terminal City, they have two skaters at five penalty minutes. That's Buffy St. Fury and Griffith. Then right behind her, Sugget, at four penalty minutes. I think what's important to note for Terminal City is that these are blockers. They're not jammers. So their jammers have been relatively clean in this game.
So I do think, though, that there are several penalties for them to investigate here. Let's take a look at that. Insubordination really sort of stands out as possibly Buffy not being able to hear.
Well, Buffy St. Fury, when she was given the low block, what had happened was New Hampshire's jammer, Swerk, that had basically gotten low blocked. Buffy St. Fury looked up, was confused onto the call, but had left the track immediately. So I'm not sure. And she looked stunned when she was sitting in the Notorious R.E.D. penalty box that she was given an insubordination.
Agreed. I'm not sure also. Let's take a look really quickly. We do have that back block from Griffith. So a couple of penalties a couple of penalties in the last few jams for Terminal City, kind of skewing things the way New Hampshire had it in the end of the last period.
Yeah.
This could be an opportunity for them moving forward, but I know Terminal City wants to figure this out.
Yeah, absolutely. In the second half, by the way, New Hampshire only has four penalty minutes. So New Hampshire has played a very clean second half so far, as the clock is frozen in 18 minutes and 48 seconds. And this is a great time for me. Well, actually, no, it's not a great time for me. We're going to go back to action.
It's a great time for the jam.
That's good.
And we do have Swerko out there unopposed. Jammer-wise, she is lead jammer. We do have 3-on-2 back advantage for New Hampshire now. This is an opportunity for them to make up some lost time here. The no-pack call is made. Pack reforming quickly. And great work from New Hampshire trying to open up some space for their jammer to get through that no-pack. Just the pack getting the no-pack call, reforming very quickly. Great work from Terminal City slowing it down.
And it was great speeding up there by Griffith to get from where she was in the back of the pack to bridge in the middle.
And that is a five-point pass for Swerko. She looks behind her to see where her opposing jammer is now out from the penalty box. And we do have another star pass. Mackenzie putting on the star now for Terminal City. Pack advantage to New Hampshire, but Terminal City not making it easy on Swerko. We do have her working her way around the front. She calls it. Good strategy there and good jammer awareness from New Hampshire to pick up a handful of points. That's four.
And it looks like we are going to have a official review. This time, New Hampshire calling the official review. Before we do that, though, Bam Bam, what was the cause of Terminal City's official review?
Terminal City was questioning the cut call. They believe that they had come back legally.
Yes.
The call did indeed stand.
Okay.
So it was not due to the insubordination.
Okay, so it was the cut call.
Sometimes I'm right on my guesses, and sometimes I'm wrong here.
I am rarely right, so today is the day that I'm pleasantly surprised.
And you know what? You want to know what a right move is, Double H? Advertising right here on WFTDA.tv.
Never go wrong.
You get to talk with thousands of Derby fans by advertising right here on WFTDA.tv. There's affordable packages. They're available for your business, your boot camp, or your tournament advertising. Make sure you go to WFTDA.com/sponsors/opportunities to learn more.
So plenty of time here for New Hampshire to kick the door open. They also have jammers who do not have a lot of penalties happening in this game. Punky has one. Swerko has two. Chicana Brusia has none. So what we can look for, because we do have a couple of larger penalties from our blockers, Pammy Decker, of course, with six, Emma Donnelly with five, we can look for New Hampshire to be a little bit more assertive jammer-wise, offensively, and I think that's what we're going to see with 17 minutes and 41 seconds in the second period, Kim.
And Bam Bam just handed me a quick note here. I have no problem with giving him credit for this because he thinks the insubordination on Buffy St. Fury may have been because she cut across the middle of the track to the box instead of around the track. So if that is the case, that can be considered an insubordination by the letter of the law because you're not following the referee's directions. But Double H, as a referee for the Philly Roller Girls, do you think that's a call that you would make?
That's not a call that I would make. Of course, I would always check the rules to make sure what the right call was. There was a part of me that wondered if that hadn't been an illegal procedure then, if that was the case, but certainly something to investigate, and it's got to be the right call if it's the call this officials crew is making.
Yeah, because we have some really, really good officials here.
And they've done a very good job from crew to crew throughout this tournament of being consistent and on it, and that's Sugar Daddy out there as the crew head ref, and I do work with him in Philly. I know him very well, and he is one of the most painfully fair human beings I know, and I say that with love.
Painfully fair.
Painfully fair. That's... Sometimes as a skater, painfully fair is, that's the painful part, but also painful, we've got two jammers now back on the track. That is Aveda Peron and Game Overies. Game Overies coming up behind a two-all. That's Flower up at the front. Oh, great work bracing there from Terminal City. Now a three-wall. And good job recycling Overies all the way back. Get forced to the inside and down. And now opening a hole for Terminal City. Lead jammer status, Aveda Peron.
And Aveda Peron did a really, really good job. About a hole created by the Terminal City blockers. As it looks like Emma Donnelly is being sent out for another penalty. This time a clockwise block. This is going to be your sixth penalty minute, Double H.
I have to tell you, Terminal City has done a great job not getting stopped block penalties with all of this bracing going on. Game Overies is through for initial pass, but Aveda calls it pretty immediately, putting a stop to that run.
So 4 points picked up here by Terminal City. That's going to make it 181 to 95. About 16 and a half minutes left to go here in the game.
Bam Bam has no bananas for us. No bananas today, he says.
You'd think I'd know how to work a microphone. Okay, it's on. So there was just a quick question. New Hampshire was challenging the attempt of the star pass. They just wanted to make sure the legality of it. It did stand.
Very good. Thank you, Bam Bam. We do have Kim Janna jamming for Terminal City, Chicana Brusia for Skate Free or Die. I'm not sure I would have burned that official review.
Yeah, I don't know if I would do the same thing. I also don't know if I could talk about that correctly, but that's but you know, sometimes it's just a matter of fighting on behalf of your team.
All right, Kim Janna coming up behind, finds a beautiful outside lane to grab 4 points and call it, leaving New Hampshire scoreless right there. And it looks like CN Spots might have gotten hit in the face. One of the opposing Terminal City blockers was actually checking on her. She's skating all the way over to the bench and she looks like she might have gotten hit in the face.
So lining up next here, it is going to be Barbaric, number 45 for Terminal City, jamming against Swerko, number 60. Really one of the breakout stars, I think, of this tournament. Her and Chicana Brugia have both done fantastic work for New Hampshire.
We are 4-on-3 pack advantage for Terminal City and looking for an outside line. She finds it. Barbaric comes up against a three wall of New Hampshire defenders. Nice brace, and she does beat it. Bam is forced to let her go and races back to the pack to join her teammates, trying to do some work for their jammer, who is getting forced to the outside, doing really good slow work is Swerko up at the front. That's Eve, Hollows, and Ingram really keeping her at bay. She's still staying on the track, though, Kim. They did not force her out of bounds.
And I think what's interesting is the theme of this tournament seems to be that no offense whatsoever. Terminal, especially with Terminal City, they play a lot of defense, and they're trusting their jammers, which is very, very good faith in their jammer set.
And you know what? Their defenders have, to their credit, really not gotten a lot of stopped block or clockwise penalties with all of those braced walls going on.
Looks like Live in Fear is back in action. However, unfortunately for her, she picked up a multiplayer block there. She's in the notorious RID penalty box.
So that was a 5-point pass also for Terminal City. Swerko working on a two-wall up at the front. That is Ko and Eve Hollows. They got the warning. Actually, both assessed a penalty. Two inside pack refs assessed a penalty to Eva Hollows, so she is going to the penalty box, a notorious RED penalty box.
Yeah, she she impeded the progress of Swerko outside of the pack definition, which is why she was assessed that out-of-play penalty. And I just want to go ahead and take a quick bit of time. This is a rough transition, I know, to tell you more about Fast Girl Skates, because just as I like to educate the fans at home, Fast Girl Skates' mission is educating skaters. Get schooled at fastgirlskates.com.
Kim, when you're on the mic, there is no such thing as a rough transition, my friend.
I'm blushing over here now. It's too early to be blushing on a tournament day.
All right, we are 199 Terminal City, New Hampshire 95. Terminal City in the red and white. New Hampshire in the white and black. Pushing to the inside. That was a great pass right there from Lulu Demon, who actually got pushed to the inside by a defender from New Hampshire and got right back up. She is not lead jammer, though, because she did no pass, no penalty there.
And she accepted the no pass, no penalty, which is, I think a lot of skaters do that because they realize, okay, well, it means I can still score. I'll get out of the pack. I'm fine with that. And it looks like Chicana Brugia was given lead jammer status. She's going to try and even things up, it looks like, Double H's. 4 points has already been picked up by New Hampshire, by Terminal City, I'm sorry.
Yeah, and we are 3-on-2 pack advantage, and that is Chicana who calls it. She does get 4 points on that pass, so that was good calculation on her part.
Last jam was a wash there, as it is going to be it's going to be 203-99 in favor of Terminal City, as 12 minutes remain here in the game. And of course, Lulu Demon, McKenzie, and Barbaric were also on the 2011 version of Team Canada and were breakout stars a while ago. You can actually check Team Canada versus Team USA from ECDX on the archives here on WFTDA.tv.
And we do have game ovaries jamming for New Hampshire against Aveda Perron, who is through to become lead jammer. Quick work of that pack. She makes it through, still getting forced down into the inside. Game ovaries working her way through. And that was just two defenders. One of those is Buffy. She's getting sent to the penalty box, I think, for that hit.
And that is going to be a clockwise block for Buffy St. Fury, as well as Bash from New Hampshire picking up an out-of-play penalty. Buffy St. Fury now one penalty minute away from fouling out of the game.
And Aveda Perron gets 4 points. Looks at game referees and calls it.
And it looks like in jam 33, Emma Donnelly picked up another clockwise block. That was her seventh penalty minute. She has fouled out of the game.
Buffy St. Fury also sitting at six penalties. Pammy Decker, same thing. So we do have five penalties for Live in Fear and another five penalties for Griffith on Terminal City.
And I believe also Suggett and McKenzie both sitting at four penalty minutes as well, Double H.
Chicana Brugia jamming against Jana. That's Kim Jana. We've got 3-on-2 pack advantage Terminal City. I'm sorry, pack advantage for New Hampshire. We do still see Chicana, though, trying to duke it out against that two wall. New Hampshire really has let their jammer kind of duke it out offensive-wise.
Yeah, both of these teams seem to be taking that approach and letting their jammers basically find their own holes. They'll play occasional bits of offense, but for the most part, it's just solid defense.
Kim Jana through to become lead jammer for Terminal City. And that pack is really spread out, but the out-of-play call hits that front two-wall of Terminal City defenders. Chicana is through. She is not lead jammer. We're 3-on-3. With both jammers rounding up the pack, Kim Jana calls it. No points on that pass.
And penalty-wise, New Hampshire has 31 penalties. Terminal City has 30 penalty minutes. So very even on the penalty minute board, or the inside whiteboard, if you prefer.
And we are looking at game ovaries lining up on the jammer line against Barbaric. And it looks like there's some nice goodwill going on out there.
Some little love going on. And I'd like to show some quick love because our next jam is brought to you by Rydell Skates, the official skate of the WFTDA, with unmatched quality and unmatched performance at RydellSkates.com.
Barbaric threw her back wall really quickly of her teammates coming up against Seeing Spots and Live in Fear. They are really working on her, but she gets past them on the inside to become lead jammer for Terminal City. Beautiful work on the outside, though, for Game Ovaries, who goes through for her initial pass.
The look of determination on her face. She's looking to make up ground here, Double H.
Falling to her knees is Barbaric, as she calls it, for a gain of two. This is really going to see New Hampshire putting the stops to Terminal City.
And Live in Fear has picked up her sixth penalty minute in the notorious RED penalty box for a clockwise block. One more penalty minute, and she will foul out of the game.
And we do have Punky on the jammer line against Lulu Demon. Punky does have one penalty. It is a track cut. Same thing with Lulu Demon. Both of them in this period as well.
Looks like it is going to be 4-on-3 in the pack in favor of Terminal City.
And they slice through. Lulu Demon does a really good job coming up against Makila Queen and Decker, who is sitting on 6 penalties of her own, doesn't want to tangle with the opposing jammer, allows her to go. She's lead jammer for Terminal City.
In that bit of a scrum there, Sugget picked up her 5th penalty minute for a back block penalty.
Racing through on the inside, Lulu Demon makes it through for a 5-point pass. Punky still struggling to get past Ko at the front of the pack. Great work from Richardson, forcing her out of bounds to recycle on the outside. Terminal City defenders really putting the screws to Punky.
Yeah, some great bridging backwards there. McKenzie needs to be careful that she remains within that 10-foot marker as she recycles Punky almost a quarter of the track length behind.
And we are 3-on-3. Punky still looking for some help from her offense. Right now, Terminal City doing such a good job bracing and keeping New Hampshire's jammers behind them. Meanwhile, that is another 5-point pass for Terminal City. We're looking at 224 to New Hampshire's 99. Punky's still at it, though. She's looking for a line on the inside. Richardson has just been brutal. Ko headed to the penalty box, and the out-of-play warning allows Richardson to let Punky go.
It looks like McKenzie is also on her way into the penalty box as we have about 7.5 minutes left to go in the game as Lulu Demon calls off the jam, Double H.
And we're going to reset with a pack advantage for New Hampshire. But I think what we're seeing here is it kind of has to change. If New Hampshire wants to change the tempo of what's going on out there, they really need to work on helping their jammer out because their jammers are slightly tired. Mm-hmm. They're not really able to get through as well as they had in the beginning of the game. So I'd like to see a little bit more offense here from New Hampshire to open some holes. And right now they're lucky because they do have a 4-on-2 pack advantage, but that does not stop Aveda Perrone from getting through on the inside for Terminal City.
And before the before the start whistle, Terminal City's 2-wall rushed to the front almost all the way to the pivot line to sort of spread out New Hampshire's pack to remain in play.
Aveda Perrone turns around, calls it pretty immediately. Still, we're going to reset, I believe, with the pack advantage for New Hampshire, but it looks like there is a timeout for New Hampshire. Skate free or die.
Team timeout for New Hampshire, which gives me time to talk about Bruce Skate Noose, the original over-the-shoulder roller skate holder. Find him on the web at facebook.com/ Bruce Skate Noose.
This has been such a dynamic game. You can see the
penalties
on the inside. Thanks to our awesome camera crew and Blaze Streaming Media, they're showing you exactly what we're seeing on our Rinkster Stats interface.
And it looks like I love coming up with words out of the penalty codes here because
Campbell
is on the board.
I've seen exam.
I actually had a very geeky moment when someone had Abacab on the board.
Nice.
That's my favorite Genesis album. So I was very, very happy to see that. Not happy for that skater because that's 3 high blocks. That's kind
of
crazy.
But that really does give a lot of information. Oh, no, we have 2 Terminal City jammers on the jammer line. Which one do you think is going to actually?
I don't believe that's quite legal, in fact.
So this is enormously interesting. Okay. Oh.
Maybe it was a psychological ploy there, Double H.
I was having flashbacks to a poodle, an intentional fourth minor, and that doesn't exist anymore. But we do have game ovaries working your way against that 2-all up at the front from Eve Hallows and Flower from Terminal City. She's working on them. She is pushing, and in the back is beautiful work from Jana. Kim Jana now 1 to beat at the front for her, and she's lead jammer. She makes it right past Live in Fear.
And it looks like 3 blockers were on their way into the notorious RD penalty box. Tank Girl is going to be waved off. Pam Decker is sitting in the box. So I believe that is going to be her 5th penalty minute. Makila Queen also sitting in the box. We do not have an update on those penalties, though.
And we do have quite a few whistles being blown right now. Meanwhile, it does look like game ovaries is through, and there is an injury. But now she is back up and in action. And that was from New Hampshire. Tanked Girl, number 550, and they're saying, no, you need to get looked at.
Yeah, Tank Girl was cued for the penalty box, so someone is going to have to serve her time as well. And Sugar Daddy, one thing I know about Sugar Daddy in my conversations with him, safety of the skaters is always on his mind.
I think that's true of all of these officials out here. And I've seen a few whistles blown for over the course of the tournaments for injuries where skaters got right back up. And in my mind, you're right, safety is always the best option.
And it looks like Flower Plower. You didn't see her on the screen, but she actually got sprung from the penalty box. She reported to the box, didn't actually need to report to the box, and she was so happy that she raised her hands in the air, screamed with excitement. It's always good to see when a blocker is so happy to not be in the penalty box.
You know, she hasn't actually incurred a penalty since the sixth jam of this game. So to her credit, I think I would have been a little bit confused as well. But now they are mixing up the rotation on their bench. We continue this time out.
And that gives me more time to talk about our proud partner and the official wheel of the WFTDA. That is Adam Wheels. You can find them on the web, of course, at adamwheels.com. And if you're still in Richmond, they are here today as well as Adam Wheels.
I think it's safe to say that both of these teams have done a tremendous job here this weekend.
Absolutely.
We're going to see them both move on to advance a seed in from coming in this tournament. They've done an awesome job. That is Chicana Brusia jamming against Barbaric.
And there was a quick correction. Pammy Decker was not sitting in the penalty box. She is still eligible to skate.
Barbaric through to become lead jammer for Terminal City. We are 3-on-2. Chicana stumbles a little at the back and is given some room by her blockers, but comes up against the two wall and is thrown to the ground. And that is Barbaric coming around for her scoring pass.
Barbaric completes the scoring pass. 5 points here for Terminal City.
Chicana still trying to work through those defenders at the front. Gets past Scarlett for her initial pass. We are 3-on-2 pack advantage for Terminal City. Trying to mix it up a little bit is Makila Queen, who forces Barbaric to the inside to call it.
So right now, 241-99 is the score as we approach the final 5 minutes of the game. Terminal City, again, coming into this ranked as the 10th seed, looking very likely that they will finish as the 7th seed. New Hampshire coming in as the 9th seed. It looks like they're going to come in and finish at 8, which is still, again, no matter how this game finishes up, great improvement for both teams, especially in the rankings with the weighted ranking system.
Game over. He's doing some dancing on the jammer line, a little celebratory dancing against Lulu Demon. She should be really happy with the performance that her teammates and New Hampshire did this weekend. Same thing with Terminal City. Lulu Demon coming up against a three wall at the front. Great work slowing it down from Cruliet Lewis, forcing her outside. Didn't draw the cut, though. Forced to the inside, but staying in bounds is Lulu Demon. She is lead jammer.
And it looks like one of the skaters for New Hampshire,
that is Cruliet Lewis.
It is indeed. It's going to be 35 penalty minutes for New Hampshire. Terminal City has 34 minutes, but Cruliet Lewis is getting her first penalty minute for a multiplayer block.
Terminal City doing such a good job. Bash just throwing flowers to the floor, saying, no, I need a hole for my jammer. And she does get one, but game over. He gets forced out of bounds between turns 3 and 4. Nice three wall at the front from Terminal City. They've done such a good job with their defense this weekend. Their bracing has been impeccable and not a lot of stopped block calls.
It's important that Richardson is also now in the penalty box for a multiplayer block. And Co, one up for Terminal City. And Sugget are both going to the penalty box. Sugget's being waved off. She's going to be queued for the box, Double H.
And Lulu Demon gonna keep going. She is lead jammer. Nope, she calls it. She was gonna keep going, but that is 4 points for Terminal City, 3-4 New Hampshire on that pass.
And right now, New Hampshire has broken the 100-point mark, 250-102 in favor of Terminal City, though, as we have about 3 minutes left to go here in this game. And we want to thank the Blood and Thunder magazine as well as Green Monster Roller Sports for partnership with the WFTDA.
And we want to thank you for watching on WFTDA.tv. Last minute move from Terminal City to race to the pivot line. That is Chicana Brusia against Aveda Peron. Chicana getting forced to the inside was actually a stroke of luck for her as she comes up against one defender still, that's Scarlett, and now Sugget, and they must let her go. She is lead jammer, and we do have a power jam, a forearm sending Aveda Peron to the penalty box. Power jam, New Hampshire.
Sugget now reporting into the penalty box for her out-of-play penalty from jam number 42. This will be her sixth penalty minute, Double H.
Chicana through. That is 4-on-1. Pack advantage, New Hampshire, on the power jam. Scarlet Bloodbath, sole defender. Now Richardson back in the mix from the penalty box.
5 more points picked up here by Chicana Brusia, who, again, I know I've been harping on this, 0 penalty minutes for Chicana Brusia.
and through on the inside. The no-pack call allows her to get through. Scarlett and Richardson must let her go. So now slowly hanging back is that four wall from New Hampshire. We do have Co back in the mix for Terminal City. Chicana fighting up against Richardson. Jukes around the outside for five more points.
So 20 points on the jam here thus far. Double H, Chicana Brusia really looking good here for Skate Free or Die. It's a name you want to look out for in the future.
4-on-3, pack advantage, New Hampshire, and she's pushing her way through. Chicana's like, no, she gets past Scarlett, and she says, you know what? I don't even need my defenders right now. I am going to get through this wall if I have to push my way, and she did. We do have Aveda Perron back from the penalty box, so now we are looking at 4-on-3, still pack advantage for New Hampshire. Chicana still working on that pack. Gets no pack call.
And not to cut you off there, but Aveda Perron back blocked in the box. She's heading in. It's a power jam continuing for Chicana Brusia.
And she very wisely calls it, says, no, I really want to reset here. Picks up five more points. And now it is Terminal City 250, New Hampshire 132, with under a minute left in the second period.
And it's important to note, Sugget in that last jam picked up another out of play penalty. That is her seventh penalty minute. She has fouled out of the game for Terminal City.
And this is an opportunity here for New Hampshire to make up some time. This is a timeout being called, an official timeout.
So official timeout again has been called in Double H. Let's talk a little bit about what we're going to see coming up here on WFTDA.TV. The fifth place game, Kansas City versus Jacksonville. It's going to start at 2 p.m. Eastern. And then we're going to see who earns that third place. To Milwaukee, Angel City, maybe a little bit disappointing, but trying to salvage it. They came in as the number one seed. They're going to play for third place against Naptown.
They still have a shot. And I think Angel City knows that. I think their fans know that. And this is an opportunity for them to stay, as we like to say in roller derby, for them to stay relevant. They can still play for a spot, and of course, Philly and Texas have already punched their tickets to Milwaukee, as I am told it is called.
That's what Alice Cooper may have
said.
That's
what AK-40 Ounce says.
Oh, dear.
I try not to believe him too much, but...
This is going to be an interesting stat for you here, Double H. Philly has made it to the final round of the playoff tournaments for the fifth straight year. Texas has been to championships every year it has existed.
Okay, so that was a little bit of an odd dance. Barbaric was on the jammer line for 1 second, but quickly made it off when she realized there's already a jammer in the box. Not in the box right now, though, is Swerko. She is jamming unopposed, and she is lead. We are 4-on-1, pack advantage, New Hampshire. Bam moves forward to make a little bit of a hit on Flowers, so she really does open a hole, and that is a five-point pass for New Hampshire.
Speaking of Bams, Bam Bam, what was that official timeout all about?
That was the pivot on her seventh foul, so the official timeout was to make sure that there was a pivot replacement in the box for her.
Okay, sounds good.
And that is Eve Hallows headed to the penalty box, the notorious RED penalty box. We do have Ingram back in the mix for Terminal City, but Swerko is through nonetheless for another five-point pass. New Hampshire on a tear here.
And you know, you've got to think New Hampshire wants the last 5 minutes of this half and the first 25 minutes of the first half to be combined and just be one, and just to have that as their game.
And they should be really proud of that. Fortunately, Swerko is lead jammer. She gets five more points, so she's in control. We have about 50 seconds left in this entire game. Aveda Perron is back from the penalty box. That is her initial pass.
So now Swerko looks like she's trying to get past Flower Plower and Richardson on the inside. Claps to call off the jam, Double H.
And that's fair enough.
That's going to do it.
That's fair.
Terminal City is going to come home to Vancouver, British Columbia. They came the furthest distance out of anyone in the tournament, and they're going to go up three spots. Came in 10th. They're going to finish 7th. New Hampshire Skate Free or Die All-Stars came in 9th, finishing 8th. A very respectable appearance here in their both teams in their first ever playoff tournament. 250 to 154, Terminal City takes home the win.
Again, New Hampshire has to be proud of the work that they did against Jacksonville in game one. They really did a great job. Moved on to play Angel City. They stood up so well to Angel City. They really gave a tremendous effort, and the game was awesome.
They did, and I think also Terminal City, that first half against Texas, go back and watch it when it's up on the archives. That first half against Texas, they looked really, really good. And I think Texas got, you know, when you throw rocks at a sleeping dragon, eventually it breathes fire on you. I think that's what happened in that game. Texas may have come in like, Terminal City? Where is that? And then they had to realize, oh, wait, they're in this to win. So,
and I think that's what we're learning about the division-based structure, yeah, is that there are no givens. And I think what we see here overall in the Division I playoffs are really opening this up to teams that we haven't seen before in the region-based playoff structure. And it's really broadening everybody's horizons. And people are getting chances they haven't gotten before to prove that they deserve to be where they are in the rankings.
Exactly. And Terminal City, in fact, is in the West region. And we know the West region in the past few years has been stacked with great, great teams. So another opportunity. We mentioned opportunities. We mentioned teams like Jet City, who are going to go on to play in the third place game at Milwaukee in championships for Division II. We mentioned Santa Cruz, you know, all throughout Division II playoffs. The new switch has provided us with a very exciting playoff season right here on WFTDA.TV.
And we're going to have two more weekends full of these.
Oh.
After this, we're going to go to Asheville, and then we're going to go to Salem, and I think we're going to see some amazing things.
We certainly
are. Brackets have been blown to bits.
And that's a good reminder, actually. Go and get your cheese balls bracket bonanza bracket filled out, because as soon as the first whistle blows on the first game of the tournament, that bracket locks. It's just like when you play your fantasy football games. As soon as the first whistle that game goes, you can't change your players. Same thing here with our bracket bonanza.
And unfortunately, my bracket has been blown to bits totally.
You're not alone, though. There's no perfect brackets left. I think mine's not too good. It's not too good.
Well, what was good today was New Hampshire's performance here against Terminal City. Again, the final score is Terminal City 250 to New Hampshire 154. So they brought it under 100-point difference, Kim.
Absolutely.
Everybody should be proud.
And I know I'm looking forward to hearing what Electra Blue has for us. So, Electra, take it away.
Hi there, this is Electra Blue here, and I'm joined by Mac the Knife, Mac the Knife from Terminal City All-Stars from Vancouver, British Columbia, eh?
Hey. Take off, eh?
First of all, congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Excellent job. And, you know, of course, behind every good team is a good coach, and I understand you won an award last year, Most Supportive Coach from the NS Hobo Award.
Yes.
So take me on your coaching journey a little bit, which also happens to include your wife, I understand.
My coaching journey, so I announced for the league for 4 years. I see Chip Queso over there. We've worked together often. I got to know the announcing corps, and then a few years ago, one of the host teams asked me to start coaching because they said I'd seen more derby than anyone in our league. And so far, so good. It's worked out well. I've been the coach of Team Canada at the World Cup in 2011, and I'm on the staff again for 2014. But I couldn't be more proud of these girls here today.
Well, you came in at 10, and you're leaving at number 7. Yeah. But I understand what you really wanted to do to this tournament was play Texas.
Yeah.
So tell us about that.
The moment we saw the bracket, I looked at the brackets, and our goal is playing Texas. So if we beat Tampa, we get Texas. So we achieved our goal as soon as we got here, which made the rest of it just icing on the cake. And as much as it was tough with Jacksonville, because we felt that was a game we gave away a bit, but they played a great game. I think we really responded well today. And coming back at 7th, first time at divisionals, I think everyone kind of knows who the Terminal City All-Stars are now.
Well, I think we do, eh? So, all right, so now you're done for today and done for this tournament. And, of course, these scores today, 250 to 154, does go towards 2014 rankings.
Yep.
So now what? You go home, do you take a little break or more work?
We'll take a well-earned break, and then we live in the Pacific Northwest. There's a couple of teams in that area called Rose and Rad and even Oli that we can get some games with, because we want to get a couple of games in the fall, some sanctioned bouts to maintain our spot. And then excited about the release for the 2014 Div 1, where we land in there and then get ready for our playing season 2014. But they've earned a break. They're going to get a break.
Well, they definitely get a break. You get a break. I get a break. But you do not get a break. Keep watching here, WFTDA.TV. Lots of good derby still to come.
Yes.